Our Bowtie Nation portfolio is up almost 30% this year and beating the market by 13%. That's a return any portfolio manager would sell his soul to achieve, but it's time to look back on those stock picks to see which were skill and which even a trained monkey could have picked. In this video, we'll review the best and the worst investments in this year's portfolio to see what we can learn about picking stocks. I'll cover the losers as well as the winners to help make you a better investor. Then I'll reveal the three trends I'm watching for 2022 and the stocks to keep an eye on for next year's returns. We're getting started, but you know I've got to send that special shout out to all you out there in the Bowtie Nation. Thank you for spending a part of your day to be here. If you're not part of that community yet, just click that little red subscribe button. It's free and you'll never miss an episode. Our portfolio on Stock Card is up almost 30% to the first week in November, with 29 of the 46 stocks beating the market. That's 2 out of every 3 stocks outperforming, and 33 of those stocks in positive territory. I'll leave a link to Stock Card in the video description below. Click through and then go to Portfolios in the top menu. You'll find the Bowtie Nation portfolio in the Stock Picks section. It's free to follow and you'll get email notifications whenever I buy or sell from the list. As a special bonus, I've negotiated an exclusive discount for all you out there in the community. Use the promo code BOWTIENATION, all one word in lowercase, for an exclusive discount beyond the free trial. Plus, Stock Card is going to double that discount throughout the rest of the year. Let's look at those best stocks and the worst to see what we can learn. Then, I'm going to show you my starting strategy for stocks in 2022. Our best performer, 163% return on shares of Diamondback Energy, ticker FANG, and this is a great lesson in doing that deep research into a sector and being able to forecast those trends. I watched rig counts, the number of rigs pumping oil in the United States, plunge last year, but saw that conflicting with increased oil demand coming on that economic growth. Now that research paid off, and 3 of our top 6 stocks here were in the energy sector, including Devon Energy and Marathon, that beat the market by more than 45% each. Nation Peter Lynch is quoted as saying, "Invest in what you know," but that's only possible by doing that kind of deep research to really understand how an industry and the companies make money. Wells Fargo, ticker WFC, is another winner with a 70% return and beating the market by 41% over the year. Everyone said I was crazy for adding shares of Wells Fargo. Not only were bank stocks lagging, but Wells was still in the doghouse with investors. But you have to know when to play contrarian, when to bet against the market, and the best time to do that is when you can find a cheap stock in an industry ready to run on those big trends. That's where I saw Wells Fargo, an inexpensive stock nobody loved, in a group of stocks ready to take off on those higher interest rates. We've also seen some great stocks in the consumer plays, like Dick's Sporting Goods, ticker DKS, and its 81% return. In fact, I added more consumer stocks to the portfolio just last month, and they're already up an average of 16%, so this is a trend that I think still has room to run. Households have trillions in excess savings, the job market is strong, and they're ready to spend that money. But it wasn't all rainbows and unicorns with the portfolio either, and some of the best lessons always come straight from our failures. 17 stocks in the portfolio underperformed the market, but 2 stand out as real dogs: WW International and Clorox. Now, Weight Watchers, ticker WW, was really disappointing because these shares were up 64% in less than 6 months after adding them, and then crashed down 73% in the next 4. And this is a great lesson on why it's really best to have at most 20 or 30 individual stocks in your portfolio. Now, that's about the max that you can realistically keep up with on that individual basis. For example, if I had been following fewer companies, I might have taken a more frequent look at Weight Watchers. I could have tied that idea of renewed lockdowns from the Delta variant and that idea that people would be less concerned about their weight and the numbers would suffer. Now, that's what ultimately happened. The company has seen declining membership over the last 4 months, and that's hitting these shares. Now, I still do like the stock back up to $30 a share, but it's going to be a while before it gets back up to that peak. The other big loser of the year was Clorox, ticker CLX, and an 18% loss on the shares, underperforming the market by 42%. Clorox was down from the start, and it really was the canary in the coal mine for inflation and weakness in consumer staples companies. Now, this is why I like following those big trends, because they will alert you to forces that a stock just can't overcome, but I failed to do that in this stock. I still like the dividend on this one, and it's a good company, but the entire consumer staples group is going to struggle with inflation over the next year. Even with those few bad picks, though, it's still tough being anything but extremely happy with that 30% portfolio return, and I'll take that market-beating 13% any day of the week. But you cannot rest on your successes. Every year is a new opportunity for a return, so I want to start us off with a 2022 strategy, and we're going to start by adding stocks in the portfolio next month. Just like with this year's strategy, I'm gonna be using that big picture view to look for those trends and then pick stocks from that. All you out there in the nation know this is my favorite way to invest because it is just so much easier to see those big picture trends and the forces that than it is to just randomly pick the best stocks from thousands in the market. By starting with those trends, you can narrow your list down to a few hundred in the sectors and industries. You can also be more confident that even if you don't pick the very best stock in that group, you're still gonna do well because those trends are pushing all the stocks in that group higher. And there are three trends I'm watching closer than anything for 2022. Inflation, interest rates, and that tight jobs picture. Consumer inflation has been over 5% for 6 months now and likely to stay that way for well into the next year. That is a multi-decade high for price increases and the market is just now starting to price that into stocks. That means there is still some opportunities left, but more importantly, you still have a chance to protect your portfolio against some of those risks. You see, along with the trend in jobs that I'll get to next, corporate earnings could get slammed next year on those higher inflation and wages. Now, some companies will be better able to pass those higher costs on to customers, but others won't, and that understanding needs to be a top priority in the stocks you buy. So here, I'm thinking stocks in the energy and real estate sectors, which tend to do better during those periods of high inflation, while avoiding stocks in consumer staples companies and utilities that could get hit hard. I'm also looking for companies in the materials sector, so those miners, and maybe energy stocks that could actually benefit as inflation rises. Related to that inflation theme is going to be higher interest rates, another major trend to affect stocks in 2022. The interest rate on the 10-year treasury, the benchmark for all other rates, has doubled in the past year. That is a huge move in borrowing rates. It's not over yet and will have a huge effect on the market. For example, when the rate on the 10-year bond increased less than 1% in the first 3 months of the year, tech and growth stocks got absolutely crushed. Stocks in the NASDAQ index, the green line here, lost 8%, and growth stocks in the ARK Innovation Fund plunged 33% in just a few months. And interest rates are expected to keep moving higher, up to 2% by the end of the year, and this is directly tied to that inflation story, so it could go much higher. So if we're thinking higher interest rates, we want to avoid tech and growth stocks, unless it's a company that you really like or have a very long-term view on it. Instead, you want to have some stocks in the financial sector, like the banks, because they're going to make more money on those loans when those rates go up. Those bank stocks were some of our best performers this year, and I'm looking for others to put in our 2022 portfolio. The third market trend I'm following right now, the crazy tight jobs picture, is a big one. I worked for the state of Iowa as a labor economist for 5 years, and I can tell you without a doubt, this is the best jobs market for workers we've ever seen. There are now more than 11 million job openings, but only 8 million people looking for those jobs. Even though the October jobs report was better, the previous two monthly jobs reports have come in surprisingly bad, with just 194,000 jobs created in September versus 500,000 expected because, well, employers just can't get those people to come back to work. The labor force participation rate, now that's the percentage of eligible workers employed or looking for a job, is now just 61.6%. That's the lowest it's been since 1976. Case in point here, the website for the community bank I use has a notice. Due to staffing shortage, all lobbies are closed. Can you imagine that? All 9 locations forced to close because they can't find enough workers. Between millions retiring over the last few years, people dropping out of the workforce on their investing profits, and people that are still afraid to go back to work, there is a historic worker shortage, and it's going to lead to higher wage pressures next year. Now, that's great for workers, but companies are going to get slammed on those higher costs. For a lot of industries, employee wages are about a third or more of their total costs. Increasing that is going to destroy profits and hit the stocks. Now, some analysts are recommending the freelancer and work-from-home stocks like Fiverr, Etsy, and Shopify on those trends, and they could be good picks, but I'm looking in a different direction. I'm focusing here on stocks of companies with greater percentage of their sales from online compared to their peers. That focus on e-commerce means these companies won't have the staffing needs and won't have to fight for workers. Profitability won't get hit, and the stocks should outperform. In fact, this is a theme we've already highlighted in our 3 October stock picks, adding Tapestry, Signet, and Capri Holdings to this year's portfolio, and producing nearly a 16% average return in less than 3 weeks. Now, all 3 of those companies have focused on strong e-commerce growth, and it's coming through in those bottom line earnings. We'll be looking for more companies like that for our 2022 portfolio starting next month. Check out the 2021 portfolio on StockCard or click on the video to the right to be ready for the coming stagflation bust, how to be ready, and the stocks to buy. Don't forget to join the Let's Talk Money community by tapping that subscribe button and clicking the bell notification.